Hello, anatomy colleagues. This is Dr. Alsup, and it is my absolute pleasure to get to discuss the general osteological features we need to know for this session. This will be a first where I think the osteology may actually be our longest dissection video. And it's not just because osteology is my favorite, which it is, but because there are so many important foramina that we need to be familiar with, particularly with the neurovasculature that traverses this region. The focus on this video will be on being able to actually identify and distinguish these structures, and a little less so as to what goes through these structures as it's considered in the learning objective. But first, I want to get started with some basic terminology that you will hear us use quite often, and these are calvaria and basocranium. So just to get our bearings, we are looking at a lateral view of the skull, and we know this is the skull. The term skull means the cranium, which is everything except the mandible. This right here is the mandible or the lower jaw. So when you have the mandible included with the rest of the cranium, then you are looking at the skull. The cranium is composed of the facial region. All right, so all these kind of facial bones right here, just kind of a generalized location, as well as the neurocranium. And the neurocranium is basically everything else. It is the portion that will protect the brain. And the neurocranium is further subdivided into these two basic areas that we want you to know. There is going to be the cranial base, so anything kind of in this bottom portion, inferior, extending towards this region as well. And the cranial base is often referred to as the basocranium. That's the actual term for it. And that's where the brain sits. And this is actually where we'll spend the majority of our time in this video, as this is where the cranial fossae are located, as well as the majority of the foramina. The other portion is called the calvaria. And you know, this is kind of give or take. This is not a very set line, but the calvaria is often called the roof of the cranial vault, or more crudely, we refer to this as the skull cap. And it's the calvaria that we will be removing in the craniotomy to gain access to the superior portion of the brain. So sometimes it can be a little bit more superiorly placed in terms of this line. There's a little variability in terms of what you'll see in different sources. All right, now let's move on to a view that we will be using quite a bit. And in this view, that calvaria, or the skull cap, has been removed, as well as, of course, the brain and associated meninges. And we are looking superiorly at an internal view of the basocranium. So this is where the brain would have sat during life. And as we know from the learning objective, this area can be divided into three cranial fossae, which are arranged in kind of a stair-step fashion from the shallowest anterior cranial fossa to the deepest posterior cranial fossa. And I always know I'm looking posterior because of this big hole right here, the foramen magnum, is always going to be posteriorly placed. So I know this direction is anterior. The anterior cranial fossa spans from the frontal bone, specifically the squamous portion, or this anterior flattened portion, back to the lesser wings of the sphenoid. So the lesser wings are going to be right here. This is a lesser wing, and this is a lesser wing. And so this whole area right here is going to be considered part of the anterior cranial fossa. Recall that there are some differences between resources whether this medialmost portion is included within the anterior cranial fossa. Sometimes you see it with the middle, but for our purposes, we do include this portion in the anterior cranial fossa. So anterior cranial fossa is here. The middle cranial fossa extends from the inferior portions of the lesser wings of the sphenoid to the apices of the petrous part of the temporal bone. So this whole region right here is the petrous portion of the temporal bone. And the apex is kind of the top or most superior portion of this petrous part. So over here would be the apex on this side. And so this middle cranial fossa will be between the lesser wings to the apex of the petrous part of the temporal bone. And lastly, the posterior cranial fossa extends from those same apices of the petrous part of the temporal bone all the way back to the occipital bone, specifically the squamous portion of the occipital bone, or kind of the back of the head region. So posterior cranial fossa is located here. Okay, let's turn our attention to the foramina associated with these fossae, starting with the anterior cranial fossa. And let's hone our attention to this small median bone right here in the middle, referred to as the ethmoid bone. The ethmoid is so wonderfully complex, as you can see just in this small area, how much is going on there. And running right in the middle, I'm kind of outlining it right here, is a projection referred to as the crista galli. And this is actually the anterior attachment site of the falx cerebri. So remember, that largest dural partition that sits in the longitudinal cerebral fissure will anteriorly attach here. And running all over the place next to the crista galli are these small foramina. And these are referred to as the cribriform foramina, which will transmit olfactory axons of cranial nerve 1. So associated with cranial nerve 1. Moving a bit posteriorly, we get to the sphenoid bone, which is my all-time favorite bone. And that is saying a lot because I love all of them very, very much. But one of the biggest characteristics of the sphenoid are the two sets of wings. We pointed out the lesser wings in the last slide, but here they are again. Here are your lesser wings. And you can see kind of where the suture is for the sphenoid here. You can see how we have kind of this butterfly shaped, and this region right here is associated with the greater wing of the sphenoid. Just medial to the lesser wings of the sphenoid, there will be the optic canals. And I'm going to circle the optic canals here. And these are going to lead into or away from the orbit. So the ophthalmic artery as well as cranial nerve 2 will traverse the optic canals. All right, let's continue our exploration of the sphenoid bone. But now let's move into the middle cranial fossa. So just under these lesser wings of the sphenoid, so almost completely occluded from view, you can see a little peak right here of the superior orbital fissure. And again, as mentioned, this is going to be inferior to the lesser wings of the sphenoid. We will see the superior orbital fissure in an anterior view in a few slides, which you can see quite a bit better. Lots of neurovasculature heading towards the orbit or away from the orbit here. So you're going to have, you'll have cranial nerves 3, 4, as well as 6 that are going to traverse this region. And then you will have the sensory, one of the sensory divisions of the trigeminal nerve, or V1, the ophthalmic nerve traveling through there. Okay. Just posterior to those optic canals that we saw associated with the anterior cranial fossa, you will have this divot of bone. It's kind of like a saddle, sitting in a saddle region. This is referred to as the hypophyseal fossa, and it is going to accommodate a portion of the pituitary gland. So sometimes you see this with an E here, same thing, hypophyseal fossa. So that's where that a portion of the pituitary gland will sit. And as you can see, it's very well protected by bone, as that's a very important gland in that region. All right, lateral to the hypophyseal fossa and a component of the greater wings of the sphenoid is a trio of foramina, or a paired trio of foramina. The more anterior an almost perfectly rounded one is what is referred to as the foramen rotundum. And the foramen rotundum allows the maxillary nerve, or the second division of the trigeminal nerve, to traverse and exit the skull. Just posterior and slightly lateral to the foramen rotundum is the foramen ovale. So here are the foramina ovale. And the foramen ovale is going to allow the third division, or the mandibular nerve, the third division of the trigeminal nerve, often referred to as the mandibular nerve, to exit the skull. V3 is larger than V2, thus the foramen ovale is larger. Lastly, posterior lateral to the foramen ovale is this little pinprick of, and I should really draw this right here, this little pinprick right here is going to be the foramen spinosum, so a much smaller foramen, and that's because you have the relatively small middle meningeal artery, which is ascending to enter the skull to supply the meninges. So rotundum, ovale, spinosum. Okay, now let's focus on the posterior cranial fossa. Again, recall that this whole region right here, I'm going to outline it on this side, is referred to as the petrous part of the temporal bone. It's a rock-like portion. And we have that apex right here, which is that demarcation between the middle and the posterior cranial fossae. On the petrous part, there are going to be two openings leading into the internal acoustic meatus. So it's in that general region there. It's not quite as easy to see on this side, but it would be right about here. And this leads into the deeper portions of the petrous part of the temporal bone. And within the petrous part of the temporal bone, you're going to have both the middle and the inner ears. The facial nerve, as well as the vestibulocochlear nerve, so cranial nerve 7 and 8, those are going to enter into the internal acoustic meatus. Facial nerve will eventually make its way out of the skull, or most of the facial nerve will, whereas vestibulocochlear goes into the petrous part, heading towards that inner ear region, and it kind of sticks around there. All right, next, let's move to the jugular foramen. The jugular foramen is actually located between the temporal bone and the occipital bone. And as you can see here, as I'm outlining them, they are very irregularly shaped. They don't even look the same on either side. And that is because we do have those dural venous sinuses draining in this region, and that's where the internal jugular vein begins. And so veins have varying pressure, therefore we have this variably shaped foramina right here. Additionally, you're going to have cranial nerves 9, 10, and 11 traversing the jugular foramen, so glossopharyngeal, vagus, and the accessory nerve. So much going on with the jugular foramina. Moving to the occipital bone, there is this dominant hole that I think is pretty easily distinguishable. That is the foramen magnum. And it's at the foramen magnum that the medulla oblongata will transition to the spinal cord. Additionally, the accessory nerve will ascend through the foramen magnum to almost immediately exit through the jugular foramen. So you do have the accessory nerve associated with both the jugular foramen and the foramen magnum. Also, those vertebral arteries will enter the skull via the foramen magnum to be one of the dominant suppliers for the brain. And lastly, close to the foramen magnum and a bit more anteriorly placed, you have the hypoglossal canals. And this is the means by which the hypoglossal nerves will exit the skull. Now, as these foramina are transmitting neurovasculature, it makes sense that we will be able to see some of those structures we've just discussed in an inferior view as well, which is what we're looking at. And here we're looking at a cranium, not a skull, because the mandible is not present. So this is upper jaw, maxillary region. A few structures you can see well in this view include the foramen ovales, which you can see on either side, as well as the foramen spinosum, right here, and right here. You can't really see the foramen rotundum very well. It's hidden here by the pterygoid plate of the sphenoid, so it'd be kind of tucked up under that region. Moving posteriorly, we can see the external openings of the carotid canal right here. And so this is the means by which the internal carotid artery will enter the skull. And there's a very complex directionality once we get past that region. But for our purposes, we do want you to know at least this general region where it enters the skull. And lastly, of course, hopefully you're starting to feel familiar with the large foramen magnum, which is clearly visible from an inferior view as well. And before we leave our conversation on the osteology of this session, I did want to look at this anterior view with a focus on the orbit. And two of the openings that we have discussed are also visible from this view. This almost perfect circle right here is going to be the optic canal, which you can see very clearly, almost perfectly rounded, whereas we have this more irregularly shaped fissure right here, which is the superior orbital fissure. And so recall, we couldn't see the fissure very well from that superior view of the internal basocranium, but you can very clearly see the size of the superior orbital fissure here. So quite visible when you're looking into the orbit from an anterior view. And you have some other foramina and fissures in this region, which will obviously transmit neurovasculature as well, but these are the two that we want you to focus on. All right, excellent. Thank you for working through the osteological structures of the cranial cavity and brain session. Take your time to review and always feel free to reach out to me or any of my anatomy colleagues with questions. Have a great rest of your day.